All right.
Oh, everyone. Nicole, welcome. Nicole, so good to see you here. I'm so glad you came. Renee,
Hi.
Amy, welcome.
Amy and Mel, thank you for being here.
Hi,
Hello.
Nicole.
Hey.
So glad you're
Hi.
here. How you doing, Mel?
Good, good. How are you?
Good, tired after the conference. Still working.
Oh,
So yeah, pretty crazy.
bet. Yes, absolutely.
Oh,
It was wonderful, by the way. Great job.
thank you. I love your wearing your shirt. Representing.
I'm dog, team dog.
Oh, team dog. Nice. Nice.
Sophie gives a high five for that. High paw, team dog.
Right. I know Liza said she was going to be joining us too today. So
Okay.
give people a couple more minutes and then we can start.
I'd like to make an announcement. Next month on March 9th, I have a big birthday. I won't say how old, but I would like to make a $50 donation to Sarah.
Oh, that's
Oh, that's
so sweet. Thank you. That's so nice of you.
nice.
Every penny helps us so much. Oh my gosh, you guys, something really exciting happened. So, PetMeds sent out their email, just to about their stuff. They said, "Can Reiki help your pet?" And if you click on the article, Sarah is mentioned in the first paragraph. And at the end, it said, "To learn more, study with a let animals lead practitioner." So that's very exciting for us. Very exciting. Because the Let Animals Lead Way is the most respectful animal Reiki system that's out there. And so it's very exciting that we were acknowledged. Now, it was obvious a bot wrote this article. I'm going to be completely honest with you there, but at least we got some play. And so that was really exciting. So that's pretty darn exciting news.
Here's Lisa.
Yay.
All right.
Yeah, that's a large market.
Yeah, that's a very large market.
And
Hi, Beth.
typically,
Hi,
typically,
Beth. Hi, Lisa.
it's typically pretty mainstream pet meds,
Yeah.
it's going to reach that audience.
Yeah, isn't that crazy? So that's exciting for all of us that are doing animal Reiki because it makes it more normal and mainstream, like you were saying, Nicole. Yeah, very much so. Hey.
It's like balancing the pharmaceuticals with the holistic
Right.
and to move it over to the holistic. Like they're saying we're okay to do it instead
Yes.
of just taking the pharmaceuticals. I like that.
I do too. I do too. And it said, it's a complementary, which I liked. It said,
Yes.
it's not in replacement of, it's to complement. So that's really exciting too. Hey, Wilma, welcome.
Wilma.
So Liza, Beth, and Wilma, we were just talking about how PetMeds sent out their email yesterday to their email tribe. And actually, do you know who alerted me to it? Was Kristen at CARE, at the CARE Foundation. So she said, "Did you see this?" And it was PetMeds said, "Does Reiki help your pets?" And in the article, the first paragraph mentioned Shelter Animal Reiki Association and World Animal Reiki Day. And then at the end, it said, study or get a treatment from a let animals lead practitioner. So it's very specific. So for all of us, really amazing news. And I think that we can all celebrate that, right? So in order, because we've got a lot to share today. So usually what we do, for those of you who are new, we usually go around and we share one win because we want to get excited. But today we have a big win. And so we're just gonna play some music for just a second. And we're gonna be excited that animal Reiki was mentioned in the mainstream. So move around, ladies, get excited. This is exciting for us. It's exciting for you. Woo! Yes. Ah! All right. So there was that. So, but normally what we do is, oh, Nicole, you're so funny. I love that so much. Show your little journal. So, let's get into our topic. But again, normally what we do is we go around and we share one win. And the reason we do that is because it helps us feel good about ourselves, but it also helps you feel supported by this community as well. So what Jamie and I do that's a little bit differently than most of the Animal Reiki talks or shares that you're going to go to is we're all about positive mindset and about supporting you and what you're doing and answering questions and helping you to feel really good about and confident about what you're doing and what you're sharing. So whether you're brand new to this or whether you are a teacher in the Let Animals Lead way, we support it all. And what's really wonderful about these calls is that you get a lot of different perspectives and information from a lot of different people. So Liza is a teacher, Mel is a teacher, Wilma is taking the Animal Reiki for Reiki practitioner class. Beth, you're a teacher too, aren't you? No, you're not a teacher yet. So Beth is a practitioner. And Nicole, I'm not sure, are you a teacher or a practitioner?
Practitioner.
Okay, practitioner.
I had to unmute.
Yeah, so great. So Renee and Amy, do you have any experience with the Let Animals Lead way? Or are
I'm
you?
I'm a practitioner.
You're a practitioner, great.
Yeah.
And Amy, what about you?
Well, I attended the Sarah event over the weekend, or was it the weekend?
Yeah.
I don't know. I just got over COVID.
I'm so sorry.
That's okay. My head's just still confused.
Oh, I can relate to that. I have long haul COVID. I mean, I'm in speech therapy and physical therapy, and mine was 2 years ago, but I had it really bad.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I'm nervous because, this is the first time I got it. I thought I was immune and, it's really messing with my head.
It does. It does.
And over the weekend, as much as I wanted to participate so fully in the event, I had to just do it in, you know, spurts. And like, I mean, there were times I couldn't even look at the computer. So,
oh, yeah, totally. I can't emphasize so much.
So anyway, it was a great, great event. Really, congratulations and thank you. I just am upset that I couldn't take advantage of all the relationships I could have made. But I'm in the Animal Consortium chaplaincy program.
Yes. Oh, nice.
So, yeah. So we're about 2/3 of the way through that.
And wonderful.
Besides that, just my whole life been, I was an animal control officer. I worked in animal shelters. I had an animal ambulance service for years. So in one way or another, it's mostly domesticated. I've done a lot of wildlife, rescue rehabilitation as well, but, I'm trying to break away from that world because the compassion fatigue is just, you know, it's very depressing. So I'm trying to do things that obviously are still animal related, but, and I did Reiki 20 years ago for people, but not as it applied to animals. So I'm looking for new avenues of how I can redirect my energy to obviously continue to keep supporting the animals, but not in a, I mean, the shelter environment is so toxic. So anyway, that's why I'm here.
Well, a couple things, Amy. So the Whova platform, where everybody still is kind of, is still open. It's open for 3 months. So you can go in there and, you know, ask questions. And if you go to the community forum, there's meet and greets. Greets is one of the topics. You can go in there and see if people are going to do any more meet and greets. You can go into the topics that people are talking about and comment, because I'm going to go in there today. There were some questions about animal Reiki and animal communication, and there's some confusion, like we're against animal communication, but we're not. And people aren't understanding the reason we keep it separate is because it's two different modalities. And so they were saying, oh, well, we only like this. We don't give the other one a chance. And that's not true. What we want you to focus on is creating a supportive space. Animal communication is active. You can't have a calm, supportive space if you're actively trying to have a conversation. So
we do
encourage people to do animal communication, but do it after the animal Reiki session, you know, so that if you're getting messages, if things, then you ask the animal. But if you try to do both at the same time, you're not doing either one properly. So, I'll go on there. Exactly. And so I will definitely be going on there today. So go on there and make sure that you comment and share. People will be. I know my friend JT, who does the dog training, I think she's having a meetup. So there's lots of things still going on, even though the conference is over. So be sure to just go in there and interact, and you can go to the attendees and you can send messages if there's an attendee that you want to connect with. Okay. So I encourage you to do that. It's, yes, it's over as far as like the speaker sessions, but the community is still open for 3 more months.
That's great. Thanks for keeping it open.
Yeah. Hey, Laura, welcome. So we should get into our conversation now. And Jamie, I don't know if you want to start off.
Well, today our topic is really making that connection to the animal through meditation and ways that we can do that, how we can do that, what happens when we don't feel like it's happening. And, you know, that is the whole part. And what's beautiful about what we do, you know, is especially for like Amy, that this, yes, it is, it takes you deeper into this connection with animals, but it also helps you so that because the shelters and, you know, some of the animal welfare, there is a high rate of burnout. We know that the compassion fatigue is real, and this works for us. So as we're sitting and we're meditating with animals, it's not something we're doing to them. It's something that we are doing with them. So we go in, we begin to meditate. We're doing this with the animals. We're not doing it to them. So as we go in, we're also being healed from all the emotional trauma that we may have been through in this crazy animal welfare world, because it's tough. It's hard on us. We know that. And this is another tool that you can use to help yourself as well as the animals. And so I just wanted to mention that, Amy, when, you know, as I was listening to you talk, that's what came to me, that this is such a wonderful place for you to be. And we're so glad you're here, because this really does help us just as much.
Absolutely. And also, Amy and everybody else, I don't know if you took advantage of the fact that we were giving away our introduction to animal Reiki, which we usually sell for $49 for free in our booth, the Animal Bonds booth. And so if you sign up there, you will get access to, it's a 35-minute webinar, and then a really nice little workbook that you can, you know, kind of journal in. It has little prompts, but it also has the written 3 very simple meditations. Like, you know, we're not asking you to sit down and meditate for 30 minutes. These are all very simple ones. Thanks, Wilma.
Thank you, Wilma.
Very simple meditations that you can do anywhere at any time that really help you calm yourself and help you to start getting more into your heart and less out here and up and into your emotions. But also there are 2 guided meditations. So if you want to do a little bit longer meditation, I think the guided meditations are 10 minutes each, aren't they?
I think they're 10 minutes. Yeah, they're short. Yeah,
they're not really long, because you don't have to do it for a really long time. What's most important is that you just get yourself back into that calm kind of balanced space. So be sure to take advantage of that, Amy. And if you can't find it, you can just reach out to us via email or via the platform, and we'll make sure you get on it and we'll have our assistant send it to you.
And so Nicole asked if the link went out, but Nicole, did you go to our booth and sign up? Okay. And you haven't received it yet? You should have.
Yeah, it went out yesterday. Okay. Yeah, let us know. And we'll make sure. Yeah, because it did go out yesterday. And if you signed up at our booth, now I
was out of it yesterday, so I'm gonna check now. Okay.
Oh, Laura got it. Yay.
Okay, Laura got it. Good.
Yay. Perfect. And Laura's representing today too. She's got her shirt on, I can see.
Yes.
So, the smile meditation is a really good one. It's so simple. And maybe Jamie, you could do that at the end today, the smile meditation, and then go into the regular meditation. But I love the smile meditation because it is an immediate way to get yourself out of feeling bad, right? You know, like when you can think of something that can make you smile, like for me, the one thing I can say is bunnies. And then I just can't help but smile. It's like, I can't help it, but it just smile. And so for me, like, I'm feeling bad. It's just like, okay. Like, okay. It just, everything goes away. And so there's really simple hacks, because Jamie and I are all about hacks. We're all about easy peasy. We're not about making things hard and long and, okay, now you got to go into this deep meditation. Da, da, da. We know that that's not possible. We know that that's really hard for all of us to do. So we want to give you ways to go into this place simply. And so when we're sitting, so our, you know, our theme is how to connect deeply to animals. When we're feeling bad or we're feeling bad about the animal, then we really can't connect, because you can imagine, like, let's say you're in, we'll say where you're in prison, right? Okay. You're in prison and you're locked up and someone comes to visit you and you have the person that goes, oh gosh, I can't believe you're here. Blah, blah. And everything is wah, 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 right? That's a bad energy. But if someone comes in and says, oh my gosh, I'm so glad to see you. I'm so glad we have this time together. I'm so glad that I am able to have this ability to sit with you and let's just be together. That's a different energy, right? And so when we go with the animals, it's really important for us to just leave our crap over here for now. Like, okay, I'll think about that later. But when we sit with the animals, we really want to be sitting in that space of love, gratitude, compassion, right? For ourselves too. Because even though, and this is something the Animals at Care taught us, is that even though there are some animals in cages, and I really encourage you to go on Hoova and watch the videos from Care, because there's three of them total from Care, because you will see how happy the animals are. They're in cages, but they are happy because they are living in the moment. And that's something we don't do. We live in yesterday and we live in tomorrow. But this moment right now, we won't, we don't want to live in, because there's something about the present that we just like, oh, well, the present's just here. I care about what happened yesterday and I care about what's going to happen tomorrow, but we're not caring. But really animals show us that that is where the true joy lies, is just in this present moment. Because in this present moment, you can be happy. You can be compassionate. You can be joyful, peaceful. All of those wonderful things for yourself right now in this moment. Because I'm here to tell you that I had the privilege of working with billionaires. And there's one thing that was really apparent, is that it doesn't matter how much they had. And the billionaire I worked for, he and his wife had $37 billion at the time. So you couldn't spend that in 100 lifetimes, yet they were miserable. And he now is worth, I think, 80 something. And he's even more miserable because he went through his second divorce. And so what happens is you can have everything in the world, anything. When you're a billionaire, there's there's no such thing as no in a billionaire's world. But if you don't have happiness, if you don't have inner happiness, you have nothing. And that's something that the animals show us. So when we can connect with the animals, it really helps us remember that inner happiness that's already in us, but that's been buried with guilt and pain and trauma and negative thoughts and doubt. And also from all the stuff that we're carrying from our childhood, because it stays with us a long time. It is ingrained in us, but meditation can help us let go of that. And I don't know if you want to say some more on that too, Jamie.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the meditation that we do for ourselves, you know, our practice, our self-care, all of that really does help reprogram our subconscious and our brain. So some of those old messages we got that are hindering us, that are keeping us, you know, from living the kind of life that we want to live and finding that peace and just being in the present moment and just, you know, because we all have this spark of divine intelligence, divine consciousness, whatever you want to call it, inside of us. And it knows exactly what we're here for, what we should be doing, how to be happy and joyful. And it's all those programmings and the lessons that we were taught, you know, as we were young by people who, you know, they didn't want us to get hurt. They looked at it, oh, this is like a really dangerous world and you got to be careful. And they're giving us these messages, not because they wanted to hinder us. They were trying to avoid us being hurt, and they weren't in tune with that inner self, mm-hmm. right? And as And I think that's what I love about the animals is, for the most part, they are in tune with that, their inner self, that true self that is inside them. And when we sit in meditation and we let go of our fear and our ego and our anger and all that stuff, and we just go inward to our true self, we're not even focused on the animal. We just focus on this true self inside of us, the love, the compassion. The animals are attracted to that. They're like, oh, I reckon you're one of us. You know, mm-hmm. They know that. It's like there's that kind of reckoning where it's like, oh, you're one of us. They don't see this physical form. They're feeling that energetic form of us, because that we're more energy than we are physical. And so are they. And so I love it. I like to think of it as I sit in meditation with them, I'm just becoming, I'm going into this beautiful light that's inside of me, and I'm attracting them. And that's all I have to do to attract them, mm-hmm. You know, and then the connection is made.
And we talked last week about how, you know, they might tell you to back off a little bit, but they're not really telling you no. It just might be like, look, it's just like if someone, you know, we all have those bubble poppers that get right in your face, right? Oh, so yeah. For us humans, we need somebody to be right there. But for animals, you can be 6-7 feet away and that's still too close. It's still, you're in their bubble. You're in their energetic bubble. You need to get a little bit further out. And so a lot of times, especially with this practice, the way we practice by going inward, by just focusing on letting go of our anger, our worry, becoming more grateful, more humble and compassionate, that energy is really welcoming. Like Jamie was saying, that is where they're going to connect. But they're not going to connect deeply with us if we're worried about, oh my gosh, look at this poor animal. Or I'm doing animal communication. Oh, the animal's telling me this, blah, 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 blah. Well, how can you relax? You know, you're focused on what's wrong and not on, okay, at this moment in time, we're just going to focus on this support. One of, I'm in Kathleen's level 3 again. And one of the girls, she had such a great analogy for what we do. She said, we're more like therapists, right? Like when you go to a therapist for your emotional needs, and which is what we do for animals, we help heal their emotional traumas, right? We're not here to do their physical, it's the emotional. And so she said, when you go to a therapist, you're not expecting them to heal you. You're expecting them to create a supportive space. Oops, sorry. A supportive space where you can heal, right? And I thought that was such a great analogy, because when we sit with animals, we're creating a very beautiful, supportive space where then they can start to let go and they feel supported and they feel our love and they feel that deep connection. And now it's safe for them to start letting go of the trauma that they're holding on to. So the more we can let go of our own stuff, the deeper that connection with the animals can be. Jamie, I don't know if you have more to say too.
Yeah, I'm just replying to Mel there because she asked about our intro to Animal Reiki, but you can get that, Mel. It's really, you know, and it's, we're so used to, like with the world of Reiki, that we're doing something and mm-hmm. we're focusing on the animal and we're focusing on the problem. And this is so opposite and so simple that I think in our human minds, we think, oh, this couldn't possibly work. It's too, you know, I need to be doing, we're doers, right? I need to do this. I need to do that. And it's like, no, you don't need, you need to stop doing. You need to just be, go inward and allow the animal to be, you know, attraction. It's all about attraction. And I know when I go out to the ranch, the sanctuary that I go to, sometimes though, I've had horses come up to me and like, they just plopped up right against me and I couldn't see and I couldn't move. And it was like, they just were getting as close as possible. It was a little intimidating because they're, you know, big animals, but because I get right out there with them, you know, we don't have to stay behind any fences or anything when I go out there. And then there's other times when I've had like the same horse and I show up and it just goes out into the pasture. And that could be a no, like not right now, or it could be, you know, I'm going to go out here and graze and I still feel your presence. I recognize you. I, you know, I know you're one of us. I'm just going to go out here and do my thing and you carry on and do your thing. So they respond differently each time.
Well, we talked about that last week too, about horses.
Yes.
When the horses accept you, they're not all up on you. They're like, okay, you can be part of our herd. You can be part of our group. And will accept you, and the relaxation that you see, even when they're 20 feet away, you start to see them slowing down, you know, they start to see them just like relaxing, maybe they hang their head, you know that they are connecting with you. But we expect, you know, animals to be all, we're so needy, right? We want them to be all up on us. And it's a codependency. We want them to like us. And if they don't, then we have to feel bad. And that's not how it is, because in their world, that's not how it goes. So I know, Nicole, you brought up empathy when we had our call, remember? And we're all empathetic people. We're all empathetic creatures. But when one thing at Brighthaven that I saw all the time was when an animal was getting ready to pass, three cats would surround it, whether it was a dog or whatever. Three cats would hold vigil around the animal. And they weren't taking their little kitty paws and going, oh my gosh, are you okay? Are you okay? Oh, we have to do this to you. They were just holding space. And that was such a deep lesson, because that is what we need to learn to do, to let go of all kind of attachment to an outcome, to let go of all attachment to the path or the future, and to just sit and hold space, because that is where the power lies. And yes, of course, we want this animal to heal, but what does that even look like? What does healing look like? Maybe it's time for them to go. Maybe they want to go. And wouldn't it be better if we could say to the animal, I love you. Thank you so much. I just am so honored to be here, and send them off with that, as opposed to crying, oh my God, I can't believe you're leaving. Because animals, they don't want to leave us. They're there for our support. So when we're crying and emotional about their departing, it's harder for them, right? You know, how many of us have had animals that have literally hung on even so much longer because we weren't ready to let go? And I am so guilty of that. I mean, one of my dogs, I still look back and go, oh my gosh, I have to send healing to myself over that, because I know he doesn't hold any grudges. I mean, this poor dog could barely even move, and I just wasn't ready. And so finally, when I was ready, he let go. But they're leaving us, but they're not leaving us. The physical body is leaving us, but their spirit is always with us, and we can always connect to it. It's just our limited belief system, right? We're like this, now they're gone, and that means they're gone forever. And it's not true. In fact, one of my little dogs, Reba, who passed away, I've been talking about her a lot recently because of Rockster, the Rockster dog food that our sponsor. Rockster did an amazing job for Reba. And sadly, we couldn't get it for like 6 months before she passed. And she was in a homeless camp. She was a very young dog, and she would eat rocks and things because she was food insecure. They didn't have enough food. And so she started to eat weird things again. But with Rockster, she stopped that. She was getting all her nutrients and everything. So anyway, I've been talking about her a lot. And it was funny because when I was over at Michael's house with the other two big dogs that she had, you know, she doesn't know this little dog, but she had lived with those two. I could hear her walking in the house. I could hear her, like, it's so weird. And I know, okay, she's here. And then my partner, Michael, is like, I've just been talking to her a lot lately, and she's just been coming up. So, you know, it's only us that believe that we can't have that deeper connection, not only with animals that are here, but animals that have passed as well. And so when you learn the let animals lead way, you learn the healing bridge meditation. And that's a really nice one to use to connect with animals that have passed. And I know some of us have experience with that. And so it's a really wonderful meditation. But even the meditations, the Joshin Kokyoho, the breath of light that you get in the intro packet, just that alone, just grounding yourself and then opening your heart to your animal, then that too can bring a connection. And Jamie, I don't know if you want to say more about that.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I found, and then I'll get to Nicole's question in the chat. When my animals are passing, and it's at home now, but when Tulip was passing, all the animals laid right around her. Mm-hmm. You know, and it was a very beautiful, peaceful thing. She was able to go, she was able to let go of her fear, you know, and so having that support, they just know having the support so you can make this transition. And it made it a very beautiful thing because, you know, in the past, I have had some where I was the same way with, I was very upset and I was crying and it was just awful at the vet. And then when I came home, I was on the couch. And I was depressed. And like for a weekend, I just stayed on the couch. And then I noticed Tulip, who I had then, and she had come from the shelter. She had a tough life. And so she had made a lot of progress. But as I got depressed, she did too. She quit eating. She quit drinking. And that's what snapped me out of it, because it's like, oh no, I've worked really hard to bring her out of her shell and I cannot do this to her. And one was in the laundry room sleeping on Zuby's blanket. I mean, they were just like, and yet when Tulip went, I had a totally different reaction, because then we were able to just accept it, hold space for her. There was no tears. I didn't feel sadness. I felt this beautiful, beautiful connection with her that I still feel today. They did too. And when it was over, everybody just kind of, there was no depression. I didn't see any of that. And so that's the difference, that just our attitude, our mindset, what we believe, you know, can do. If
and
I'm
a mirror too, right, Jamie?
Yeah. Absolutely. They mirror what's going on with us, the rest of them, you know, and it was such a valuable lesson to see such a stark difference from when Zuby passed away to when Tulip did, and how I was had grown and I was able to do better. And then Tulip gave me the best lesson of all about that. So,
and I think it's really, it goes back to our mindset and our way of thinking and us getting lost in our thoughts, which is why this practice, the way we practice it, Let Animals Lead, is so powerful, because we're letting go of that. We're letting go of that. We're working every day on letting go of it, even just with the simple. So Amy, something that we share always is something you can start doing right now is you wake up in the morning before you even get out of bed, say three times, all is well, all is well. All is well. Before you go to bed, before you close your eyes for the night, just say, all is well, all is well, all is well. Whenever you start to feel stressed, just go into your heart. You can even put your hand on your heart. All is well, all is well, all is well. And what will happen after a couple of weeks is you start to really incorporate that, so that when you feel stressed, you go, no, all is well. Because at the end of the day, all is well. No matter what is happening, all is well. So even like when you're rescuing animals or you're around animals, the fact that you're there with them, all is well. You are a beautiful, loving being, and you're, and whether the animal wants to accept it right then, you're being a light, right? And so they can start to mirror that light. And then for you, when you're stressed and you go, okay, I'm not going to be stressed, I'm going to go sit with this animal, then you can start mirroring their light, right? So it's like, oh, I'm with you. I'm so happy. Especially like when you go to care and you're sitting with tigers, right? How can you be depressed when you're sitting across from a tiger? And Liza knows, she's been there, right? So you can't be depressed, because it's like, ah, oh, I'm just in this beautiful space. And I really encourage you to look at those videos, because you can see how happy these animals are, especially Chimera, the big liger. And he comes up on one of them, I think it's the third one, and he puts his nose right up to the fence because he's so happy. You know, you can tell that they love Kristen so much and they're so happy. And so when you go there and you sit with these animals, you realize, you know what, all is well, all is well. And they show us that even though they're in cages, they're happy. And so we have our own cages. Our minds are our cages. Our minds prevent us from really experiencing true love, true happiness, true peace, because we are saying, oh, that can't happen. This can't happen. You know, oh, this isn't good. This is bad. We're labeling everything instead of just going, okay, you know what? I'm going to let go. I'm going to let go. And I'm going to let God or let the universe or whatever that is. Because remember the law of attraction, what you put out is what you get back. What you put out, and it's true. I mean, it's the law of attraction. Of course, that was made kind of mainstream, but really it is just the law of what you put out, you get back, no matter what that is. So yeah, Amy, go ahead, please.
Yeah, yeah, I like that idea. I just have a question about, like, you know, like a sort of like the county shelter where I live, you know, got in trouble with the Department of Agriculture because they were stacking, you know, 36 inch wire crates like three high with dogs, and the feces and urine was just, you know, dripping down onto the ones beneath it. And it's been going on like that for about a year. And so now they're not, now they've closed their doors. So now they're, now people are just throwing dogs and cats out on the street because they have nowhere to put them, because the shelter is not allowed to accept animals, because they're not correcting the poor management. But I have a hard time saying all is well when I know that's going
on. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, you know, and so here's what helps me, and then Jamie, please share what helps you. What helps me is that, you know, that's a horrific situation and people are just not good. I mean, I was just reading a story about those kids, those 12 kids that were being abused by their parents, and then they went into foster homes and the foster people abused them. So it's like, you know, you hear these things and you're like, oh my God. But what helps me is that you have to incorporate the light within you so that your light shines all the time. I mean, there's bad stuff. We can't cure everything, but if you can shine your light, it does help, because when we all connect together and our light becomes brighter, it helps. If you can just say, you know what, all is well, I'm sending love and compassion, because those animals, this is one thing, like we were talking about our energy, those animals feel it. Those animals feel your love and compassion. Yes, these people are horrible people, but if you can just go, you know what, I'm going to go inward and I'm going to send so much love and light to that shelter. And you would be amazed at what can shift from you focusing on the positive as opposed to the negative, you know, and it's hard. This isn't easy, Amy, especially when you're seeing that and you're seeing what people do and you're like, what the hell, how can you do this? Like, these are beings. It doesn't do us any good to go there. Right? Because what we're putting out is negativity. We're putting out, even though that we're not directing it to the animals, that's what the animals are feeling more and more of. They're feeling that negative energy. So you're mad at these people. The animals don't know that. They're just feeling more anger, more anger, more anger. But when you can be like, you know what? I'm sending love and light. Then the animals are like, there's a little breath of fresh air, right? It's like, oh, and they're energetic beings. So at night, you know, just send love, send light. When you wake up in the morning, when you're still in that kind of subconscious state, send love, send light. All is well, all is well. Because there are times when things, miracles have happened. You're just like, okay, I don't know how that happened, but it did. You know, and so you don't know, maybe a rescue group will come in. We had that in here in Oregon. One of the shelters was not taking care of their animals. It's like a year long of abuse, right? So finally, the Oregon Humane Society stepped in and they got a bunch of other rescues to step in and come and take these animals. So, you know, it might not happen tomorrow, but if you can really focus on your heart and the beautiful light within you and shine that light when you hear bad stuff, especially on Facebook, I always get bummed when people are like, this poor dog, blah, 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 instead of saying, I'm going to send love, please everybody send love to this dog, because they are energetic creatures. And I've shared this before, but I'll just share really quickly. When we went to care, you know, I had met these tigers only for like an hour aggregate, but I had such an incredible experience with them. I would meditate every day, and Kathleen got cancer during that, breast cancer. So I was meditating every day with these tigers, just every single day. Well, when we went back a year later, these tigers didn't know us, but when we went back, when I went up to Tigger and Pumpkin, like, they heard us talking and they do this chuffing. And they started doing that. They started rubbing on the fences and they acted like we were their best friends, because I had been meditating every single day, bringing them into my thoughts, and they felt it. Now, my limiting beliefs are like, I'm making this up, they're not with me. But the reality was, every time I thought, they felt it, because we're connected. Quantum physics proves we're all connected. So we have to really watch our thoughts. And even though we feel overwhelmed, this is so much. I mean, if you think about the suffering in the world as a whole, it's overwhelming and too much. So all we can do is be the light. Because just think, if everybody just turned to light within them, the world would be a different place. So we have to be that mirror, right? We have to shine the light. We have to shine our love. And that's why all is well, just practicing that, Amy. And, you know, just giving yourself that grace when you do feel bad, just say, it's okay. This is sad, but I'm going to shine my light. I'm going to shine my love. And hopefully that helps.
And I like to think about, I like to remind myself that when I focus on growth.
Yes.
So if I'm focused on all the problems, ARC shelters are the same way. People are, we had one totally shut down. Now it's back up. Hopefully it's doing better. The main one that gets government money, every time you turn around, there's some horrific story and people are picketing it. And I don't want to go protest against it. But if they do a march that is pro-animal, I want to go do that.
Right.
And so I don't want to put my focus on that negative. There's people there that are doing that. And I love them for that. They are the warriors. They're going out. They're battling. That's not me. I want to keep my focus on the positive. So rather than, you know, I know that's going on. So I'm going to go to the park and I'm going to sit and I'm going to be with the wild animals there and send energy and love them. And keep that positive. If they want to do a march that is, you know, for the animals at the shelter and we're going to raise money and we're going to march to raise money for them or whatever they might do, something positive, I would be part of that. But I don't want to be part of the negative because then I'm just creating more of that. And that's what I believe, that what if I focus on that negative, I'm just making it bigger and bigger and more stronger. Absolutely. So how do I do that? I take away the energetic strength of that problem by not focusing on it, by focusing on the joy, by focusing on the love. And that's hard to do too.
Laura said the shelter where she worked lost their contract with city council, voted for another company to run it. So long story short, they had to go in and clean up the shelter 5 months later and rebuild. Yeah. And it's overwhelming, right, Laura? But, you know, just stay, I don't know if you want to unmute yourself, but just staying in that positive helps.
Yeah. So I got retained back at the other location and, you know, both locations were actually really good with animals and we have really good, you know, okay, we have euthanasia, but there's compassion there. And what was I going to say? The people that took over actually were constantly attacking staff, like myself, and telling us that we should die and stuff like that because of the fact that we did euthanasia, which actually in the sense of the whole situation was almost, sorry. But the thing is we kept a positive outlook on the fact that we would come back and like take care of the animals, but they were actually like overstocking the kennels and putting like dogs on either side of the kennels, and it was so disgusting when we got back. It was so gross, but we rebuilt and we kept it positive. And then I had to rebuild the TNR program from scratch. Yeah, we kept it positive. And now I'm going back into the shelter and I'm actually doing a wellness program for the staff.
Wonderful. You know, and that's the whole thing too. Like people think euthanasia is bad, but sometimes it's for health reasons. It's for, you know, aggression reasons. It's animals aren't afraid to die and there is no shortage of suffering animals. There is no shortage. And if you're stacking dogs and some are sick or, you know, can't be adopted, you know, you have to find the balance there, right? Because there is literally no shortage of suffering animals. So Nicole wants to know, can you please describe some concrete examples of a no with dogs? They're going to growl, snarl at you. You know, it's going to be aggression. Or they're going to go into a corner and shake. It's just any type of extreme reaction. But if they're like pacing and kind of barking, just back up until they stop. And if you're in a kennel and they're barking, you know, we always say just go to the side so you're not staring right at them. Just or go where they can't see you and just do your meditation.
But if it's a
What if it's a private client or a, you know, a one-on-one, and they're there to receive their Reiki treatment and they do that? What do you, how do you handle
it? Sometimes you just have to say, you know, your dog's not ready. What also I like to do sometimes, I know one girl in one of my classes, the dog was inside the house. She was outside the house and she just sat and did meditation. And the dog actually came up to the door where she was close to and laid there, but he didn't want her in the house. So you can say, you know, let me try going outside because it's energy. And let's see if that makes him more comfortable. But if not, then that's fine. A lot of times having the person there, if you can do a chair treatment with the person, so just like putting your hands here and on their neck, on their shoulder, and doing a Reiki session with them will sometimes help calm the dog down. So you could say, well, we can try to do is I'll give you Reiki, I'll give you human Reiki, and we'll see if the dog will relax. Cause sometimes it's the person that's stressing the dog out too. So there's a lot of different things you could try.
If I could just ask a quick follow-up. So I'm trying to create my independent business as sort of a spa experience where people bring their dog and they can get a Reiki treatment, or I'm certified in canine massage. And now I'm starting to think, I don't know how viable that really is. Cause like, you know, I want the integrity of keeping the Reiki separate. And
so I think Reiki with massage is different because again, you're not giving, you're not directing energy. You're not focused on, oh, you have a sore, so I'm going to direct the energy there. Okay. Right. If you're not doing that, then I think we talked a little bit about this. Oh, I think one of the girls, Lorelei, she said, what if I'm holding an animal? You know, remember, you're just love. There, if you focus on your heart and the energy of love, how can that be wrong? Right.
Right.
So it's when we're like saying, okay, I'm going to do Reiki on you and I'm holding you. And that's our intent. Cause you're sick. That's a whole different thing. But if you say, oh my gosh, I love you so much. And I'm so happy to be here. That's different. So when you're doing massage, you can be like, oh, you know, I just love touching you. For my dog, Shrek, he's an old arthritic 13-year-old pit bull. It's funny because we have laser. I have a laser wand and I do it and I'll kind of, you know, just do light circles and I can feel his body just because, you know, I'm doing like slow breathing and just like that focus of love. And I can just feel when we're in that space together, it's like, you know, you're just flowing. You can feel the energy and it feels so good for him and for me. So it's, you know, it's like we give it this name Reiki, but really what we're doing is we're just becoming the beautiful light that is our own natural light within us. So you take Reiki classes, you can learn how to cultivate that light within you, but we're not doing Reiki. And we have to remember Asui, when Asui started this, he went on the mountain, right? So, had his epiphany, he stubbed his toe, he put his hand on his toe and boom, right? He healed himself. He comes down from the mountain. He was meditating with people, not touching them.
Right.
And people started to get healed. People started to feel better. So we are actually going back to the origins of Reiki. There was no hands-on when Asui did it. That came later with Dr. Hayashi, who wasn't even a doctor. So we have to remember that we're actually going back to the roots, which was just meditation, just letting go and cultivating that beautiful feeling of love and peace and joy within us. And in that space, all healing is possible. We're not focused on, okay, you're hurt here. I need to put my hands there. Now, people, we need that, right? If I sat with you, Nicole, and you sat across the room and you just meditated and went, oh, we're done, I'd go, well, what? But if you touch me and you're doing Reiki, then I'm like, oh, I feel that, right? Oh, I feel relaxed because we're very tactile and we need that. And also our mind goes where this is. So this is why healing works. Because I like, look at poor Amy. She got COVID. I got COVID. Millions of people got COVID. Where were all the healers? Why didn't they just heal this, right? Because that's not what healing is. We're all on our own healing path. But if you tell me I'm going to heal you, and I truly in my head 100% believe it, yes, I can heal, because that's why placebos work. Because you can convince yourself of that. Oh my God, Liza's dogs are cracking me up. They're all just sitting there and they're like, yeah, that... Exactly. We second what she's saying.
Well, I was just going to say real quick, I'm also doing a part-time job as an assistant behavioral trainer, and it's a room, and there's about six dogs and their owners, and I'll just sit on the bench on the side and do my Reiki, and it kind of, not only does it, you know, do the animals get it, but the owners get it, and it kind of heightens the whole.
Well, and the owners get it more deeply, because when you're doing it and the animals start to connect, now that energy is big, it's risen, right? And so now the humans can now easily connect into that. That's why meditating with animals is so powerful, because once the animals connect, then it's like, oh, and especially if there's a lot of animals, like in a herd of horses, or you really feel deeply that connection. And I just wanted to acknowledge Laura, when we were talking about animals passing, she said her golden boy gave his favorite toy to her black lab when she was starting to get ready to go. And I love that so much, because animals teach us compassion, right? They teach us what true compassion looks like. And we don't have to fix. That's not what we're here to do, unless you're a vet, and even vets can't fix everything. You know, we're all on our own healing path. And so I'm going to have to bounce off. I have to go to another meeting, but Amy, I have so much compassion for you. I will send you Reiki tonight. I had COVID really bad in November of 2020. So there wasn't the vaccine or anything yet. I was bedridden for almost 3 months, and it's taken me, it took me the first year just to even get halfway decent. And then this last year I started doing speech therapy. I've been doing physical therapy for almost 2 years now. So it is a journey. But when I got sick again in November, I got COVID a second time, it wasn't quite as bad, but your brain really, it messes with your brain. It messes. So you got to just give yourself grace and compassion that, you know what, you're just kind of stupid for a while. I would have to remind my partner and my mom, they'd be like, I'm like, hey, I'm stupid. Remember, I'm stupid. Don't expect anything of me. I am stupid right now, because you like simple things. I couldn't even like sometimes pouring a glass of water, I pick up a glass and go, oh yeah, I'm pouring water. You know what I mean? Like you get like this, it's almost like your brain shorts out for a second. So much compassion. Thank you so much, everyone. I'm going to let Jamie take it over from here. Love you all. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Leah. Have a great day.
Thank you. You too. Bye, everyone.
All right. So does anyone have any other questions or any comments they'd like to make? If not, we can go right into our meditation. Looks like everybody is good. All right. Then why don't we get ready to meditate? Oh, yes, guys. If I can get a little comfortable, I have to move the dogs. And we want to sit with our spine straight, but not stiff. And let's just take a couple of deep breaths right now. Release any stress or tension of the day. Feel yourself relax. And then go ahead and place your hands in gassho and set your intention to go inward to this beautiful light, to hold space for everyone and yourself that is in need of love and healing and compassion. And for all the animals that are also in need, we're just going to hold space. And you can keep your hands in gassho, or you can place them in your lap, whatever's comfortable. And now take a slow, deep breath in through your nose and pull it all the way down to your belly. And just hold it. One, two, three. Four, and then exhale. Take another deep breath in. And as you pull it down to the belly, it's igniting this beautiful light inside you. And hold it. One, two, three, four, and then exhale. And exhale that light back out. Take another deep breath in. Pull it all the way down to the belly, really igniting that light. Hold your breath. One, two, three, four. And then exhale, relax, and allow the light to shine out into the space around you. Take another breath in. Pull it all the way down to the belly, igniting that light. Hold it there. One, two, three, four. Exhale, relax, and allow the light to shine out into the space around you. Let's do two more of those. Take another deep breath in. Ignite the light. Hold. One, two, three, four. Exhale and relax. And allow that light to shine outward. Take another breath in. Slowly, deeply pull it down to the belly, igniting the light. Hold. One, two, three, four. Exhale, relax, and allow that light to shine outward into the space around you. And now just allow your breath to find a natural rhythm. And just feel the space that you have created. Your whole body just glistens. Every cell is full of the light. Feel your body relaxed. The tensions have melted away. And now go ahead and invite any animal, any person, anyone in need of support and healing. Invite them into this energetic space that you have created. Letting them know however they decide to participate is fine. Hold that space for them, letting go of any expectations, not even focusing on who shows up. Just stay focused on this beautiful light inside you. Just stay present with light. If your mind wanders, just go back to focusing on your breath. It's perfectly okay. Don't beat yourself up. Don't follow the thought. Just notice it and let it go. And focus on your breath. Now, allow a smile to come to your face. Notice how your energy responds to your smile. Just hold that. And then slowly let the smile relax. And notice your energy now. Now, allow a smile to form again and notice your energy. And then allow the smile to relax. And now decide if you want to have a relaxed smile or a smile as you sit in this space. Just stay present, holding space, being the light. And now bring your hands in Gaza once again. Give thanks to the Reiki and to anyone who showed up to participate with you. Take another deep cleansing breath all the way down. Pull it all the way down to the belly. It's anchoring you back into this plane. You feel your body, the furniture you're sitting on, the room you're in. And when you're ready, go ahead and open your eyes. So, oh, Mel had to leave. Okay, we're good there. So thank you, everyone, for being here. Amy, Nicole, Liza, Renee, Beth, Wilma, Laura, it's so wonderful to see all of you. Mel had to leave a little early. And you know, you can always come and go. If you can't be here for the whole thing, don't feel like you, if you just can't come for the whole meeting, that you can't come. If you have to come late, that's fine. If you can only be here a few minutes, that's fine too. So everyone have a wonderful week. I'm going to put some information in here before I go.
I just wanted to say thank you for the reminder about when your mind wanders. I've done Vipassana for 25 years, and I can tell you understand that people think meditating sometimes is about escaping the thoughts, and it's really comforting to, you know, remember that our mind is going to wander 100 times and we bring it back 100 times.
Yeah, we can't escape those thoughts, but we can control our focus. That we can control. We can't control the mind. That's what it does. It thinks all the time, but we can control our focus where we put that. So thank you, everyone. And Mel, oh, Mel's not there. I was going to say I'll get the thing sent to her, but, and Nicole, I put my email in there. So, all right. Thank you, everyone. Hopefully you can join us again next week. Bye, Renee. Bye, everyone.